Hi everyone, it's Paul from This Design That. Today we're going to be building our own portable LED tubes that look something like this. And I want to say thank you to PCBWay for sponsoring this video. If you have an idea, PCBWay can offer pretty much every fabrication service you'll ever need to turn that idea into reality. And it doesn't just stop at the prototype stage. PCBWay now offer full OEM services from proof of concept to full turnkey manufacturing. They're also running their fifth PCBWay annual design competition, where you can submit your design and have a chance of bringing it to reality and winning some great prizes. There are also many runner-up prizes up for grabs, from thousands of pounds in cash prizes to Raspberry Pi Picos. Links will be in the description, so be sure to check out PCBWay.com today. This is a very simple build, and I made these because I wanted to add some practical lighting to the shelves in my living room for my Drift Deeper shows. The shows are quite long, averaging about 2 hours per show, and I couldn't find a battery-powered option that would last long enough for 2 hours and that was also cheap enough that I could put one on each of the shelves in the background of my living room. To give you an idea of the cost it would set me back to light up the shelves, if you take a look at something like the Godox TL60, which is probably one of the cheapest tube light options out there, they will set you back approximately £210 each. And while yes, they do offer much more control, you do get a mobile app, and they are also battery powered. For what I wanted, which was just to add a touch of color to the background scene in my streams, they were overkill and far too expensive for the setup I required. First, let's break down the cost of how much this setup cost me. I got a 5 meter RGB CCT 24 volt strip from AliExpress, and that was £60. I bought 5 1 meter aluminium housings and diffuser hats for £50. I bought a 10 meter real ribbon cable used for daisy chaining the tubes together, and that was £10.50. 250 watt LED driver, which turns out it was completely overkill for this setup. I'll go into it later in the video, but that was £45.50. I got a Zigbee LED controller. This was £28.99, but it is available on AliExpress if you're willing to wait up to 6 weeks for delivery for £23. I also needed a Zigbee bridge, which was used to control the Zigbee controller from my mobile phone, and that was £22. But on AliExpress, again, you can get them for about £15. And then I bought Molex connectors, which are what I use for daisy chaining, and that was £10 for a set. And if you don't already have them, you will need the basic electrical tools such as soldering iron, flux, solder, JST crimper, and wire strippers. So altogether that come to about £230, and with this I get 5 individual LED tubes. I don't have the control and versatility that I would have with a Godox setup. That is that each one of these tubes, they all have to be the same color because they are all running from the same controller. Obviously you can get separate power and controllers for each tube, and then you could obviously control each color individually. For this setup, if I set one color, then that is what all of the tubes will be because they're all just daisy chained together. For the fifth of a price of a Godox setup, I would say that this is a comfortable compromise for what I need. Now, looking back, I'm kind of kicking myself that I didn't go with a pixel LED setup. With a pixel LED setup, each individual chip in the LED strip is addressable and controllable. If you use this setup, but you had a pixel strip in here, you would be able to control each individual LED, and therefore I would actually be able to assign different colors to each tube. And also you can do effects where you can kind of like shift through the colors and create gradients and those type of things. It's not really that much more for the LED strip, and the controllers are not really that much more expensive either. Obviously they're not as bright from what I can find. They are about double the price for the LED strip. So mine was £60 from AliExpress. From what I could find, a similar one, 24 volt for 5 meters, pixel LED, which was RGB, is about £120-£130. So, you know, it does add a, you know, significant increase in the cost of the budget. But again, I mean, that increase in price would give you a huge amount more control and functionality if you need it. Definitely something to think about if you want that kind of individual tube control. I wanted this setup to be easy to change according to my needs. Most of the time, these will be sitting on the shelf in the background of my shows. There probably is going to be some times when I want to use them in videos or to maybe add some color to some B-roll and those type of things. And that is why I wanted to go with this kind of daisy chaining setup where they're modular. I can, you know, plug in up to 5, or I can just plug in 1 if I want. I decided to use Molex 6-pin connectors. These were the best option I could find that were robust and also low priced. If price wasn't a concern, I probably would have gone with something like a Nutric connector, but the price of one female connector for a Nutric 6-pin was something like £13 to £15. And I would need 10 of those, let alone the male connectors for the daisy chaining cables. And you can obviously see that, you know, the price of just those connectors alone would have probably been more than this entire project. I designed and 3D printed a chassis for the female Molex connector to clamp into. This would slot into the aluminium housing and make sure that the connector would not wiggle around, which would cause wire and solder breakages over time when I'm plugging it in and disconnecting it. And if you want to print or build these yourself, files will be in the description. All you need is some threaded inserts and some M3 bolts. To wire these up, it's very simple. I am a complete novice when it comes to electronics, so hopefully I did this right. So first of all, I laid down the LED strip in the aluminium housing. Most LEDs will come with a double-sided tape on them, so this was very easy to do. Just peel it off and stick it down. I then stripped and crimped the connectors. Then after placing the Molex connector in the 3D printed chassis, I could trim the wires to the right length. Next, I stripped this end of the cable, and you want to tin your wires with a little bit of solder. You also want to apply a small amount of solder to the pad on the LED strip. Put the tinned wire on the soldered pad and give it a little bit of heat from the solder iron, and it should fuse together quickly. Next, I just used a hot glue gun to fix the wire down onto the 3D printed chassis. And that's all there really is to wiring up these LED tubes. It's just 6 wires, and you just need to make sure that the connections are in the right place. Now, because the daisy chain cables could only be plugged in one way correctly, and I'll show you an illustration of what I mean here, if you flip the wire around, the connections will be flipped and no longer work. As a solution, I made sure that I color coded each end with a different colored filament. And I also designed the male connector that had a larger push lever on it, as I found trying to push in these tiny small latches to disconnect the Molex connectors was quite annoying. Now, with color-coded connectors, I had no issues knowing what end to plug into. Next, I wanted to make a carry holder of some sort for the electronics of this setup. You could build a box or something like that, but honestly, I just wanted something that would mean that it was all in one place and I could just hang it away when I'm not using it. I decided to CNC a plywood holder that would fit the main LED driver, the LED controller, and a holder for the plug so it could be stored away easily. Wiring this up is really simple. The LED driver came with the wiring attached. I just needed to wire in a plug for the 230 volts, and then the 24 volt positive and negative would push fit into the LED driver. And then from there, you just had your 6 labeled pins that were also push fit. I was a little bit apprehensive about how secure these push fit connectors are on this thing, because I've actually never used this type of connector before. I'm used to using screw terminals on power supplies and things like that, but actually these hold really tight. Once you push it in, you do need to make sure that obviously all of your wires are tinned, because if you've just got wires and you try and push it in, they're just gonna fray and it won't push in correctly. And then you can just push it in and it really does grip it very well. Now, a note about this LED driver. As I said earlier, I really don't know much about electronics, and this one that I bought was completely overkill for this setup. And I'm gonna explain why that is, because I'm sure other people will get caught out by this. So you generally wanna go 20% over what you need in terms of watts for this LED setup. If you look at any good LED supplier, they usually give you the wattage per meter. So this LED strip was rated at 38 watts per meter. So you times that 38 watts by how many meters of LED that you've got. This is 5 meters. So that come to about, I think it was 193 watts. So I rounded it up to 200, and then I added the 20% just to be safe, because you don't want to run these at 100% all the time. So I purchased a 250 watt LED driver. That is complete overkill, because the thing that you need to realize with these RGB, and this one is RGB CCT, so its LED chips are actually split into 3 segments. You have warm white, and then you have a red, green, and blue, and then you have a cool white. So when you're using, for instance, this is displaying blue at the moment, the LED chip is only using the red, green, and blue portion of the LED. It's not even using the warm white and the cool white chip. So you never actually use the full wattage of this LED strip. And actually, Auxmar, the supplier of these LED strips, are good enough to give you the wattage requirements per channel. So you can look in the specifications and it will actually tell you that the red, blue and green channels, they all take around about 7.8 watts per channel. So really a more realistic real life usage of this in terms of the watts that is going to be needed is more like 10 watts per meter, because you're not going to be using all of those individual sections within each LED chip. I hope that makes sense. So if you do the calculations now, if you do, you know, say 10 watts per meter, 5 meters, 50 watts, add 20% in, you're looking at like what, 60, 70 watt LED driver, not 250. Now, thankfully, there's really not that much difference in price compared to getting something that's like 70 to 100 watts for an LED driver. So I wasn't really bummed out that much, but yeah, it's just worth bearing in mind, this could have been a lot smaller and a lot lighter. Next, we'll install the top hat diffuser. And I want to give a shout out to The Hookup, who did an amazing video review of all of the different types of aluminium extrusions and diffusers. If you look at his results, you can see that this top hat style is a really nice combination of diffusing the light into a solid strip of light, so you can't see the actual individual dots of the LEDs on the strip, which is what I wanted to hide. And also it gives you a nice diffusion to the sides of the LED strip, whereas if you just have the diffuser flush with the actual channel, you don't get any of that light leaking to the sides, which, you know, you may or may not want, but I wanted it to really expose all over the shelves and onto the wall as well. So that's why I chose this style. And how you install it is you just push in either end into the 3D printed chassis, and then you just clip it down, working your way into the middle. All that was left to do next was to set up the Zigbee bridge. Through this, I could control the LEDs through my mobile phone. Now, this was the second mistake that I made. I bought the LED driver and I also bought the LED controller. Now, on the Amazon listing, they make it look like that through this controller, you can control the LEDs with your phone. They show the controller and a mobile phone next to it. So when I powered these up, I was trying to figure out how on earth I connect my phone to this controller. It turns out that you need to use a Zigbee bridge, which is this little thing, and this will obviously act as a bridge between the controller and your mobile phone. So that was a little bit annoying. This was like an extra £22, as I said, to buy. These things are, they're like smart hubs, so you can actually do a lot of smart automation in your home. You can do like motion sensored lights, you know, you can control things through your phone with a lot of these hubs, and you get a lot of add-ons for it. You can get like powered switches and lights that you can all control. So it's pretty cool. I might, you know, think about adding more stuff, but that's something that you need to bear in mind. And setting up this bridge and the app that you get is not very good. The documentation is pretty weak. And also the app itself, some of the interface is in Mandarin, which doesn't really help. I'll put a link in the description to a video that goes into more detail of how exactly you set up the Sonoff bridge or the Zigbee bridge, because many different brands do make these Zigbee protocol bridges. But basically, it's pretty much the same as pairing just like a Bluetooth device. First time you power this on and you turn this on, they'll both be blinking to tell you that they're in the kind of like the discovery syncing mode. It did take a few tries to get it to show up in this app, which is Ewe Link. As I said, the interface, a lot of it is in Mandarin, so it's a little bit difficult. But basically, once you are able to successfully pair it, you'll see it as a Zigbee bridge subdevice. You can click into that and then you can click on the light and then you get the full control of the light. So obviously it's got a color wheel on it, so you can change the colors of it. You can change the intensity of the light as well. And then also you can go to the white section. And this is what I was talking about with the LED, is kind of split into cool white and warm white. So you can actually mix those colors to get the color temperature that you want. I believe it goes from 2200 to 6300 or something like that. And again, you can change the intensity of the light. So typically RGB is usually what you would get for if you wanted the colored strip. I got the CCT option, which is the warm white and the cool white, because it means that I can actually use these as video lights, and I can, you know, hopefully pair the color temperature with my main video light, which is the Godox SL150, I think. Now the CRI is only rated at 80 for these LEDs, so it's nowhere near as kind of accurate as what you would expect from maybe, you know, a video light, which is usually 93, 95, maybe 96 CRI rating. But these seem to be good quality. The output is good. The color output is very, very nice, especially if you're just using it for just some background lighting like what I am. This brand as well, Auxma, I've had a look on the forums and Reddit, and they are regarded as one of the higher quality LED providers out there. And their LEDs do come with a 5-year warranty. I don't know who has actually tried to get a warranty, especially with a company based in China. It can sometimes be a little bit problematic with that, but I've heard good things about the brand. So far, I would definitely recommend them. They are nice LEDs. They do pack a punch compared to another LED strip that I've bought from Amazon ages ago, which is a very, very cheap one. I believe these are 96 LEDs per meter. Most of the cheaper LED strips you get are like 60, maybe 45 LEDs per meter. So the more LEDs that they can pack into that meter usually means the brighter that it's going to be. So I'm happy that I finally got this build put together. I've been meaning to make some lights that I can put into my shows, and also just so I can use some background lights around my house. If you don't mind the daisy chain cables or the fact that, you know, you don't have a kind of like a battery pack, these are a really, really good cheap alternative compared to the price of a lot of these portable LED tube lights, video lights that you can buy. Yeah, these just work out so much cheaper, and the output is pretty good from what I can see. Links to all the files will be in the description. Remember to like, comment, and subscribe. It really does help tell YouTube that you like this content, and it really does help to push it up in the rankings, which helps to get me more views. If you've got any questions about this build, please feel free to ask. If you've got any future suggestions of how I could improve this, I'm really thinking of a way that I could attach a battery pack to these. So I could turn these into like a Godox alternative, basically. That would be really nice, but I'm not sure how you would do a 24 volt battery. From what I could see, they're like huge, massive battery packs. And yeah, I think it would add quite a lot of weight to this. But yeah, if you've got any ideas, please do let me know. That is it for today. Hopefully you enjoyed it, and I will catch you later.